I'm Gleaves Whitney. I am proud to direct the Hauenstein Center for Presidential Studies at Grand Valley State University. Thank you very much for being here. I also hasten to thank the Presidential Library and Museum and the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Foundation. Joe Calvaruso, where are you at the foundation? There you are, front seat right in front of me. He's our partner tonight. Let's give him a hand. Thank you so much. And from the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Library and Museum, we have a partner represented here in Jim Kratzis. Jim, thank you so much. Now, as we approach the 70th anniversary of D-Day, our Hauenstein Center favorite veteran is here in the audience, and at age 102, we are so proud to recognize and honor Colonel Ralph W. Hauenstein. Let's give him a... He still has quite a bit of snap in that salute. Well, we're really excited to host Rick Atkinson at another Grand Valley event. Rick Atkinson has become a favorite of the Hauenstein Center in Grand Valley. We're just delighted to have him with us tonight. I've got to tell you, though, what happened the last couple of times that he was hosted by us. We had a really interesting moment. Rick was trying to make the point that there were 16 million men and women in uniform in World War II, and only about a million of these individuals were surviving. And Rick was saying that they were dying, unfortunately, at a very rapid rate. And to make his point and to really bring it home, he did what a good rhetorician does. He was using a visual for you, the audience. And so he was saying, yes, they're dying off at this rate. Now, that was in the morning presentation. Rick and Ralph were to appear together in the afternoon presentation. And Ralph kind of looked at Rick and he said, Rick, I'll be happy to get on that stage with you if you quit snapping your fingers. Brought the house down. Well, Rick may have stopped snapping his fingers, but thank goodness he did not stop writing. This Liberation Trilogy of his has been a blockbuster in all of the trite senses of the word, but in a profound sense, in a very important sense, he has set the bar very high for the narrative history of the most consequential war in human history. This Liberation Trilogy, the three volumes of it, each one of them prize-winning, award, accolade-attracting volumes, and it's because Rick has the ability to weave together several things that are unusual even in most writers, most accomplished writers. First of all, you see in his writing the ability to make the character sketch of a novelist that sticks. He has a great sense of plot and pacing, and he also has an unusual command of data and how to pick out the relevant data that really makes the point. And you're going to see all three of these skills on display tonight as he weaves this wonderful image for us as we contemplate the war. His Guns at Last Light is just being issued as a paperback today. So we're there on the birth of the paperback today, and that's why there's so many of them out on the counter. And we are hoping, of course, that there will be none left at the end of the evening. Though Rick has agreed to stay long enough to autograph your copies. Now, Rick, I don't know how many talks you give where your primary source material is sitting in the audience with you, as Ralph is today, somebody who actually lived so much of what you write about when the Allies retook Fortress Europe. But I think that is a high compliment to your work, Rick, that Ralph told me on Saturday morning. He said, Rick writes so well that he makes you feel as if you were in the war experiencing it. And you got the character sketches just right. I can't think of a better accolade for your writing than that which came from Ralph Hauenstein. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Rick Atkinson.
Well, thank you for that, Gleaves. Can you hear me all right back there? Good. Well, thank you so much for inviting me to Grand Rapids, hometown of the last sensible man to live in Washington, D.C. I've lived there for more than 30 years, and I know this is true. It's great to see old friends from Grand Valley here and to meet new friends, and I'm especially delighted to see my friend, Colonel Ralph Hauenstein, again. Ralph, for a couple years, as many of you know, before World War II, was the city editor of the paper here, the newspaper. And we've exchanged reminiscences about being old newspapermen. I, for many years, was a newsman in mostly the Washington Post newsroom. And I told him the story when we met the last time of my relationship as a recovering journalist now to the profession of journalism. And I told him that this is a story that my daughter, who's a surgeon, told me. And it's about the world's first brain transplant. And the night before the procedure, the doctor went into the patient's room and said, "Congratulations, sir, you're about to have the world's first brain transplant, and you have a choice as to the kind of brain you can receive. You can have the brain of an army officer that will cost you $100 an ounce. You can have the brain of a professor of history, tenured, that'll cost you $200 an ounce, or you can have the brain of a journalist. But that'll cost you $1,000 an ounce." The patient said, "$1,000 an ounce? That's outrageous. Why is it so expensive?" The doctor said, "Do you have any idea how many journalists it takes to get an ounce of brain?" Sorry, Mary Eileen. That's an easier story to tell as a recovering journalist. Anyway, I'm delighted to be here tonight. I'm going to talk for a bit, and then we'll open it up to your questions and comments in hope of converting a lecture into a conversation. Jack London said that rather than sit back and wait for inspiration, a writer ought to light out after it with a club. And 15 years ago, I took my club and went out looking, and what I found, what inspired me, was the Second World War. I started a project called the Liberation Trilogy. It was intended to tell the tale of the American military's role in the liberation of Europe in World War II. And the first volume begins where the liberation of Europe begins. It's not in Europe, it's in North Africa. And the second volume migrates as the forces of the British and the Americans migrated across the Mediterranean and tells the tale of Sicily and southern Italy. Volume 3, The Guns at Last Light, which was published a year ago and is, as Gleave said, is out in paperback today, opens on May 15, 1944 at St. Paul's School on Hammersmith Road in London, where Eisenhower, Churchill, Patton, Bernard Montgomery, King George VI, and several dozen of the most senior commanders in charge of the operation known as Overlord, the invasion of France, have gathered for the last time to review the plan for the invasion of France. They met in an auditorium at St. Paul's known as the Model Room. They were sitting on hard wooden benches normally reserved for schoolboys. The poet John Milton, among other English luminaries, had gone to St. Paul's. It was cold as a meat locker in the Model Room, despite the fact that it was mid-May, and the generals and the admirals were bundled up in their overcoats. On the floor of the cockpit of the auditorium was an enormous plaster of Paris relief map of that part of France where the River Seine spills into the Atlantic, a scale of 6 inches to the mile. And as the plan was reviewed, a British brigadier wearing no skid socks shuffled across the map with a pointer, pointing to different geographic locales as it came up in the discussion of the plan. The beaches, for example, Utah, Omaha, Gold, Juneau, Sword, and towns that would soon become famous on what would be the most famous battlefield on Earth, St. Lo, Cherbourg, Cannes, and over on the corner, Paris. Well, we are about to commemorate the 70th anniversary of D-Day, so I thought it would be appropriate to talk about the Second World War a bit this evening and try to put it into some kind of perspective 70 years after the fact. The author Stephen Ambrose, who did much to revive popular interest in the Second World War, said in 1991, "I fear that by 1995, all of us are going to be sick unto our death of World War II. There may very well be a danger of overdoing World War II." Yet here we are, 70 years after the fact, still reading about it, thinking about it, commemorating it. The historian Will Durant once calculated that in 3.5 millennia of recorded human history, there have only been 256 years in which there was not a war in progress somewhere. War is what we do as a species. Among human activities, it's so commonplace that J. Glenn Gray, who was a very erudite World War II veteran, suggested that Homo sapiens should perhaps be renamed Homo furans, man the fighter. What is it about this particular war that beguiles us? I suspect it's because of three aspects: the war's magnitude, the war's moral disposition, and the war's enduring consequences. And it's these characteristics I'd like to examine briefly. John Updike, who was arguably the greatest American man of letters before his death not long ago, called World War II the 20th century's central myth. He called it a vast imagining of a primal time when good and evil contended for the planet. A tale of Troy whose angles are infinite and whose central figures never cease to amaze us with their size, their theatricality, their sweep. Well, certainly that war shaped and defined an era, a primal time indeed, of cunning and miscalculation, of sacrifice and self-indulgence, of malice and mass murder. It was a time when heroes came forth, but it was not an age of heroes if that implies universal nobility and statuary as clean and white and lifeless as alabaster. For many American veterans, infused with irony and skepticism, those twin lenses that soldiering often nurtures, the idea that they embody the greatest generation is just silly. Now, part of that reflects rival claims from the founding fathers, the Civil War generation. But it also acknowledges that the war was too immense to be confined to a single generation. The senior military and civilian leaders, for example, were born mostly in the 1880s and 1890s. President Roosevelt born in 1882, George Patton in 1885, Dwight Eisenhower in 1890, whereas the trigger pullers were mostly born in the 19-teens and 1920s. My father, about to turn 90, born in 1924. The war lasted 2,174 days, and by the end, it was the greatest catastrophe in human history. 60 million dead. That's 27,600 dead every day for 6 years. It's 1,150 an hour. If you were a German boy born between 1915 and 1924, the odds were 1 in 3 that by 1945 you would be dead. Of a Soviet population of 190 million, 14% perished during the war. It's absolutely vital to remember that in trying to understand what's going on with Putin and the Russians with respect to the Ukraine. 60 million deaths in 6 years means a death every 3 seconds. I won't snap my fingers, Ralph. But think about it. 1, 2, 3, dead. 1, 2, 3, dead. That's World War II. George C. Marshall, the U.S. Army Chief of Staff, called it a great and terrible epoch. and new words would be required to describe it. Words like genocide and superpower, which was a neologism coined in 1944. Old words assumed new usages, words like Holocaust. The war ranged across six continents. On those titanic three-syllable battlefields that still serve as historical mileposts, Stalingrad, Tarawa, Anzio, Normandy, as well as in improbable settings rarely associated with the Second World War, places like the Aleutians, Madagascar, Syria, Darwin, Australia. The United States was among the last of the large powers to be drawn into the conflagration, but very quickly the war encumbered all of America. When the war began in earnest on September 1st, 1939, with the German invasion of Poland, the United States Army, still at peace, Ralph remembers well, was a puny weakling. By one measure, it ranked 17th among all armies of the world in terms of combat power, right behind that perennial military powerhouse, Romania. The U.S. Army in 1939 comprised 190,000 soldiers. It would grow to 8.3 million by 1945. That's a 44-fold increase. A total of 16,112,566 Americans served in uniform during the war. That was in a country of 130 million. Virtually every family had someone in harm's way. Virtually every American had an emotional investment in our military. Virtually everyone had skin in the game. Compare that World War II army of more than 8 million to our armed forces today, when we have an active army of about 500,000 and shrinking, and a bit more than 1 million if you throw in the National Guard and Reserve, in a country of 317 million. Almost no one has skin in the game. By 1944, 11,000 young men were being drafted into the Army and Navy every day. It was a rate of 4 million a year. One in three GIs had a grade school education. Only one in four held a high school diploma. Slightly more than one in 10 had attended at least a semester of college. A private, by the way, earned $50 a month, unless he earned the Medal of Honor and survived the earning, in which case he got an extra $2 a month in his paycheck. The average soldier stood 5'8", weighed 144 pounds, but the Depression had been very hard on our nation. The desperate need for bodies in uniform, especially infantrymen, to go to places like Normandy, led to the drafting of what were known as physically imperfect men. Standards had been lowered to accept defects that earlier in the war would have kept those men out of uniform. For example, draftees at one time early in the war had to have at least 12 of their natural 32 teeth. How many teeth did you have to be drafted in 1944? Zero. And that's because the Army and the Navy between them drafted one-third of all the dentists in America. And collectively, they extracted 15 million teeth. They filled 68 million more, and they made 2.5 million sets of dentures, all to enable those new recruits to be able to masticate the Army ration. I know that sounds like an obscene act, but that was the standard. By 1944, a man could be drafted with 2400 vision, if it was correctable in one eye to 2040. The armed forces made 2.3 million pairs of eyeglasses during the war. The old joke had come true that the Army didn't examine eyes, it just counted them. And in fact, you could be drafted with only one eye. You could be drafted if you were deaf in one ear. You could be drafted if you were missing both external ears. You could be drafting if you were missing a thumb or a great toe. You could be drafted if you were missing three fingers on one hand, including your trigger finger. Venereal disease had kept many men out of uniform, but that restriction also was lifted, and the Army soon was drafting 12,000 VD patients a month, most of them syphilitic. How could they do that? Penicillin. That extraordinary discovery by British scientists in the 1920s had been taken by British and American industrialists, and a substance that had been made by the gram was then made by the kilogram and eventually made by the ton. Mental and personality standards also in the armed services had been loosened. In April 1944, the War Department decreed that draftees need only have, this is War Department language, a reasonable chance of adjusting to military life. Psychiatric examiners on draft boards, however, were advised to watch for 24 personality deviations. And these included silly laughter, sulkiness, resentfulness of discipline, and other traits that would seem to disqualify every teenager in the United States. In addition, the Army began drafting what were deemed moderate obsessive compulsives, as well as stutterers. If you had a malignant tumor, leprosy, or certifiable psychosis, you were probably safe. Well, why this remarkable adjustment of the standards? It was because of the crying need for men. Even in a country of 130 million, we were running out. The Brits did run out. Ernie Pyle, arguably the most enduring of our combat correspondents, called the war an unmitigated misfortune. But in fact, for the victorious Allies, there was mitigation. Complete victory over a foe of unexampled iniquity. An existential struggle had been decided so decisively that Field Marshal Alan Brooke, who was chief of the Imperial General Staff, he was George Marshall's counterpart, concluded that, as he put it, there is a God, all-powerful, looking after the destiny of the world. In the final drive across Europe, the Western Allies in 338 days advanced more than 700 miles. They liberated oppressed peoples by the tens of millions. They seized 100,000 square miles of Germany and Austria. They captured more than 4 million prisoners, and they killed or badly wounded an estimated 1 million enemy soldiers. Impressive as that is, let's not forget our other major ally. The Red Army suffered more combat deaths at Stalingrad alone than the United States military lost in all of World War II. Soviet forces also killed roughly 9 times more Germans than the Americans and British combined. Well, the cohesion and internal coherence of the Allied coalition assured victory. The better alliance won. In contrast to the Axis autocracy, for example, Allied leadership ensured certain checks and balances to temper arbitrary willfulness and personal misjudgment. The battlefield itself in World War II offered a proving ground upon which demonstrated competence and equanimity could flourish. And as usual, modern war rewarded ingenuity, collaboration, organizational panache, and the trait that Napoleon most cherished in his generals. Anybody know what that is?
Luck.
Luck. Not to be underestimated in war. You really want it in your generals. Well, the great historian Henry Steele Commager once wrote that the Axis powers failed because they repudiated, I'm quoting Commager, human values and human faith. And from that repudiation flowed all the consequences that led to final defeat.
Yes, that's part of it. Russian blood is another part, a big part. But let's linger on the American contribution for a moment. The war cost U.S. taxpayers $296 billion. That's $4 trillion in 2014 currency. To help underwrite a military budget that increased 8,000%, President Roosevelt expanded the number of taxpayers in this country from 4 million to 42 million. The U.S. Armed Forces grew 3,500% while building 3,000 overseas bases and depots and shipping 4.5 tons of material overseas for every soldier sent overseas, plus another ton each month to sustain him. In the European theater alone, that prodigy of organization, that was Churchill's phrase for the U.S., prodigy of organization, shipped 18 million tons of war stuff to Britain and the continent. That's equivalent to the cargo in 3,600 Liberty ships. And the kit ranged from 8,000 military vehicles to footwear in sizes 2A to 22 EEE. U.S. munitions plants during the war, and there were more than a few in Michigan, turned out 40 billion rounds of small arms ammunition and 56 million grenades. From D-Day to VE Day, May 8, 1945, GIs fired 500 million machine gun bullets and 23 million artillery rounds. By 1945, the United States had built two-thirds of all the ships in the world afloat. And the United States was making half of all manufactured goods worldwide. The enemy was crushed by logistical brilliance, firepower, mobility, mechanical aptitude, and an economic juggernaut that produced much, much more of nearly everything that Germany and the other Axis powers could. Bombers, bombs, fighters, transport planes, mortars, machine guns, trucks. Yet the war absorbed barely one-third of our gross domestic product. It was a smaller proportion than any other major belligerent. So how, almost 70 years after the shooting stopped, do we assess the consequences? Well, the legacy of World War II is as profound as the sacrifices that built that legacy. First of all, of course, Allied victory strangled the sinister ambitions of Germany, Japan, and Italy. It brought an end to the British and French empires. It politically fractured both a continent, Europe, and individual countries like Germany, Korea, Vietnam. It led to the creation of both the United Nations and NATO. And it yielded a bipolar world, part Soviet, part American, that persisted for a half century. We Americans emerged from World War II with extraordinary advantages that ensured prosperity for decades, an intact, thriving industrial base, a population relatively unscarred by war. Cheap energy, two-thirds of the world's gold supply, and great optimism. As the major power in Western Europe, the Mediterranean, and the Pacific, possessing both atomic weapons and a navy and an air force unsurpassed in their power, the United States was ready to exploit what the historian H.P. Wilmot called the end of the period of European supremacy in the world that had existed for four centuries. The war dispelled American isolationism, even as it encouraged American exceptionalism. It encouraged, I think, a penchant for American military solutions to big problems, and a self-regard that led some to label the epic as the American century. Remember what John Adams told us? Power always thinks it has a great soul. The war was a potent catalyst for social change across the republic. New technologies, jets, computers, ballistic missiles, mass production of houses, penicillin, spurred vibrant new industries, which in turn encouraged the migration of black workers from the South to the North and of all peoples to the emerging West. The GI Bill put millions of soldiers into the classroom, spurring unprecedented social mobility. World War II was perhaps the greatest agent of social change in America during the 20th century. Our national evolution on issues of race and gender equality are very much shaped by the war. The U.S. military was segregated, true enough, and it was exclusionary. A long study by the U.S. Army War College on the role of black Americans in combat, written in the 1920s, so it was about black Americans in combat in World War I. This study concluded that, quote, "The Negro is by nature subservient and believes himself to be inferior to the white man. He cannot control himself in the face of danger to the extent the white man can. He has not the initiative and resourcefulness of the white man. The Negro is a rank coward in the dark. As a fighter, he has been inferior to the white man even when led by white officers." Folks, this is policy in the United States in the 1920s. When the war began in September 1939, fewer than 4,000 blacks served in the Army. By early 1944, that had grown to more than 750,000. And the disparity between the avowed principles for which the country fought and the stark hypocritical reality of American life in the 1940s gave impetus and legitimacy to the civil rights movement. Many African Americans endorsed what they called the Double V campaign, against fascist enemies abroad and against racism at home. Severe restrictions on combat roles for black troops gradually eased during the war. A group of fighter pilots known as the Tuskegee Airmen demonstrated the inanity of those restrictions, including assertions that blacks lacked the reflexes to be good fighter pilots. So desperate was the Army for riflemen during the Battle of the Bulge in December 1944 that the Army agreed to something that had been unthinkable just a couple months earlier. They permitted black soldiers to form 53 colored platoons that were integrated into 11 otherwise all-white divisions. Many of those black soldiers surrendered sergeant stripes that they had earned as cooks and drivers and laborers for the privilege of fighting as infantry privates. That modest experimentation in racial integration ended when the war did, and it would take a presidential decree to desegregate the military, and it would take much, much more to reverse three centuries of racial oppression in America. But we had seen the moral bankruptcy and the intellectual depravity of attitudes like those evinced in that Army War College study. It's also true that the Army in World War II was an overwhelmingly male institution, and it was exclusively male at senior leadership roles. There were about 1,300 generals in the Army in the latter part of the war, and not one of them was a woman. The United States Army did not promote its first colonel, female colonel, to general officer until 1970. But the extraordinary demand for military manpower, I don't need to tell a Michigan audience this, meant that women were drawn into the national workplace in extraordinary numbers. 19 million American women were working outside the home by the end of the war. And although they quickly reverted to traditional antebellum roles, there were not that many working outside the home in 1947, not that many more than had done so in 1940. That genie was not going to stay back in the bottle for long. Finally, the U.S. military in World War II was a democratizing institution. even though it was and it remains relentlessly hierarchical, 683 graduates from the Princeton University class of 1942, 84% were in uniform by 1945. And those serving as enlisted men included the valedictorian and the salutatorian. 25 classmates from that Princeton class would die during the war, 19 of them in combat. By 1945, the tectonic plates in this country were shifting. As a troop ship sailed into New York Harbor in 1946, a black soldier from Chicago said, "Glad to be home, proud of my country, irregular as it is, determined it could be better." Well, demythologizing is the task of historians, and it should begin and end with a recognition that the most excruciating legacy of World War II is suffering. One, two, three, dead. 13 U.S. divisions in Europe suffered at least 100% casualties. Five more exceeded 200%. From all theaters, American service casualties in the war included 1,700 left blind, 11,000 with at least partial paralysis of one or more limbs, and 18,000 amputations among American soldiers. A woman named Patricia O'Malley was a year old when her father, Major James O'Malley, a battalion commander in the 12th Infantry Regiment, was killed by a sniper in Normandy. She later wrote of seeing his headstone for the first time in that extraordinary cemetery at Colville above Omaha Beach. And she wrote, "I cried for the joy of being there and the sadness of my father's death. I cried for all the times I needed a father and never had one. I cried for all the words I had wanted to say and wanted to hear but had not. I cried and cried." The Australian war correspondent Osmer White, who bore witness both in the Pacific and in Europe when he was assigned as a reporter to Patton's Third Army, later wrote, "The living have the cause of the dead in trust. We the living, 317 million strong in America, have the cause of the dead in trust." I mentioned that the United States during World War II put more than 16 million into uniform during the war. And of those, about 1 million remain, and that number will slip below a million later this year. 10 years from now, in 2024, the number of surviving American veterans from World War II will be below 100,000. And in 2036, which is the last year for which government demographers have done projections, the number will be fewer than 400. It's less than half the size of an infantry battalion. Well, unnerving as that slow march to the grave may be, for the historian, frankly, it means little. World War II is the most documented event in human history, in both primary and secondary sources. The U.S. Army alone, one service, one country, produced 17,120 tons of records during World War II. That's the equivalent to the payload in 5,000 B-17 Flying Fortress bombers. We could have just flown over Berlin and buried the Germans in paper. But in sifting through those 17,000 tons, it's good to remember, in the words of the great Civil War historian Shelby Foote, "A fact is not a truth until you love it." A fact is not a truth until you love it. We're looking for facts to love, to tease coherence and intimacy from the past, to find those fine brushstrokes that bring the dead to life. They have to breathe. They must walk and talk. They have to engage us intellectually and emotionally, because the narrative writer's true calling is to bring back the dead. I write about war because war is a great revealer of character. The extravagant stress of combat reveals character. It refracts character. It allows you to see the inner components the way a prism refracts light, allowing you to see the inner spectrum. Some soldiers are classically heroic, most are not. I find myself drawn to those who are not. During the war, about 291,000 Americans were killed in action, 400,000 dead altogether. In 1947, the next of kin of all Americans who had died and whose bodies had been recovered overseas, and that was nearly all those who had died in Europe and the Pacific and whose bodies were recovered, who weren't lost at sea, those next of kin were given a one-time opportunity to fill out quartermaster form number 345. And they were asked whether they wanted to leave their sons, and they were mostly sons, overseas for burial in one of about a dozen American battle monuments commissioned cemeteries, or to have them repatriated and brought home for burial. You get a one-time choice. About 40% chose to leave their soldier overseas, and about 60% chose to bring them home. Regardless of the ultimate disposition, it cost $564.50 for each dead soldier's ultimate burial. Every grave was opened by hand, and the remains of every dead soldier sprinkled with an embalming compound of formaldehyde, aluminum chloride, wood powder, clay, and plaster of Paris. The remains were then placed in a metal casket with a satin pillow. Labor strikes in the United States caused a shortage of casket steel, and there were further delays in trying to find enough licensed embalmers. In warehouses in Cardiff and Cherbourg and other cities in Europe and elsewhere in the Pacific, the dead accumulated. Finally, the SS Joseph V. Connolly, the first of 21 ghost ships from Europe and the Pacific, sailed from Antwerp with more than 5,000 soldiers in her hold. On October 27, 1947, the Connolly berthed in New York. Stevedores winched the caskets from the hold 2x2 in specially designed slings. And a great diaspora began of these dead and those that followed as they traveled mostly by rail across the Republic for burial in their hometowns and in national cemeteries. Among those waiting was Henry A. Wright. He was a widower. He lived in southwest Missouri near Springfield. One by one, his dead sons arrived at the local train station. Sergeant Frank H. Wright, killed on Christmas Eve, 1944, in the Bulge. Then Private Harold B. Wright, who had died of his wounds in a German prison camp on February 3, 1945. And finally, Private Elton E. Wright, killed in Germany on April 25th, just 2 weeks before the war in Europe ended. Gray and Stoop, the elder Wright, watched as the caskets were carried into the house and placed in the bedroom where each of those boys had been born. Neighbors kept vigil overnight. They carpeted the floor with roses, and in the morning, they bore the brothers to Hilltop Cemetery for burial side by side by side. That's how the dead came home. But what of their belongings? What of the things they carried? Well, long before the dead came home, these things had been coming home. At a large warehouse on Hardesty Avenue in Kansas City, the U.S. Army Effects Bureau had begun as a modest quartermaster operation with fewer than a half dozen employees in early 1942. That expanded to more than 1,000 workers, and by August 1945, they were handling 60,000 shipments a month, each laden with the effects of American dead from six continents. Hour after hour, day after day, shipping containers were unloaded from rail freight cars onto a receiving dock and then hoisted by elevator to the depot's 10th floor. Here, the containers traveled by assembly line conveyor belt from station to station down to the seventh floor as inspectors pawed through the crates to extract pornography, ammunition, perhaps amorous letters from a girlfriend you didn't want a grieving widow to see. And workers used grinding stones and dentist drills to remove corrosion and blood from helmets and web gear, and laundresses took pains to scrub bloodstains out of uniforms. A detailed inventory was then pinned to each repacked container, and it was stacked in a storage bin, and all the while, typists in a huge adjacent room banged out letters, 70,000 letters a month by the summer of 1945. And the gist of those letters was this: "Dear sir, dear madam, we have your dead son's stuff. Do you want it back? Where should we send it?" Well, over the years, Effects Bureau inspectors found amazing things in those effects. Tapestries, enemy swords, a German machine gun, an Italian accordion, walrus tusks, shrunken head, a tobacco sack full of diamonds. Among thousands of diaries, also collected in Kansas City, was a small notebook that had belonged to Lieutenant Herschel G. Horton, 29 years old. He was from Aurora, Illinois, not terribly far from here, shot in the right leg and hip during a firefight with the Japanese on New Guinea. Horton had dragged himself into a grass shanty, and in the several days that it took for him to die, he wrote a final letter home to his family. It began, "My dear, sweet father, mother, and sister, I lay here in this terrible place, wondering not why God has forsaken me, but why he is making me suffer. The first duty is to remember." Our current poet laureate, Natasha Trethewey, ends her poem Pilgrimage, which is about a visit to Vicksburg, with these lines: "In my dream, the ghost of history lies down beside me, rolls over, pins me beneath a heavy arm." My ambition, as someone who has spent a professional lifetime writing about war, is for our countrymen also to feel that heavy arm, to feel the palpable presence of those who risked everything, and in some instances gave everything, for us. Thank you so much for having me here this evening. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for that. So, questions, comments, brickbats?
We have microphones, and we will come to you and hold the mic, and you can ask your question.
Right here, sir.
I can hold it.
Could you tell how you found the story of the woman who eventually visited her father's grave, and that it was just a striking spot in the book, and how did you learn that?
If anybody has the book, I'll look in the notes. to be honest, I don't remember that particular episode. I found it in, I think it was in one of the division museums, but I can't swear to that. It's annotated. Believe me, there's 200 pages of back matter. It's annotated in there somewhere. How much stuff did I read? Oh, well, now we're down to the heart of the matter. Well, I read a lot of stuff. It was a big war. I mentioned 17,120 tons of U.S. Army records. I didn't read all of that, obviously. As any writer has to be judicious about the process of researching. And My task is to determine where I can best use my time and where I can find the best stuff. So I spend a lot of time in archives. I am an archive rat. I love the mystery of the next unopened box. For World War II, those archives are scattered all over the country and around the world, really. So I spend a lot of time. Happily, some of the best archives are near me in Washington, D.C., the National Archives, the Library of Congress, the U.S. Army Military History Institute, which is a fantastic archive, is in Carlisle, Pennsylvania, a couple hours away. It's where my father lives. There are places like the 1st Infantry Division, the Big Red One, has a terrific museum in Cantigny, Wheaton, Illinois, and it's devoted to the 1st Division, as you might suspect. The Texas National Guard became the 36th Infantry Division, and they have at Camp Mabry, outside of Austin, a very fine little archive devoted to the 36th Infantry Division. So my job has been to work these sources. I go overseas. I spend a lot of time in London at the Imperial War Museum, the Little Heart Center for Military Archive, and particularly in Kew, the British National Archive. And then I walk the battlefields a lot. I've been to all these places, many of them more than once. Partly because as an amateur, I have to see the ground to understand it better, to understand the terrain and to see why they did what they did. And partly because I think the ground speaks to you. And I go to those American Battle Monuments Commission cemeteries, the spectacular one in Carthage, outside of Tunis, for example, or the extraordinary one at Natuno, at the part of the Anzio Natuno beachhead, and of course there are a number of them in France. So it's a matter of just doing the work. It's one day at a time. It's a very solitary profession, I have to say. It's not like a newsroom, which is all conviviality and people massed around you. I work alone. I work by myself. And if you're not comfortable with solitude, you're in the wrong business if you're an author. All right, we'll start back there. Yes, sir. Hang on a minute until she brings you the mic so they can hear you up here.
What bothers me about the media coverage recently about the...
I don't think they can hear you, sir. Will you use the mic?
Okay.
About the Veterans Administration is that it seems to be all about a cover-up and not about the shame of the treatment of the veteran that extends over decades. Do you have any thoughts on that?
About the Veterans Administration generally and their treatment of veterans?
At the moment, the media, I'm thinking more about your former life as a journalist, the media seems to be, who's responsible for this cover-up, rather than the shame of the treatment of the veteran?
Yeah,
which has gone on over decades, not one president or two presidents.
Yeah, whatever issues there are having to do with veterans is not limited to Eric Shinseki, former chief of staff of the Army and now the VA secretary, or to President Obama. This is not my field. I can't comment coherently on the Veteran Administration. My general feeling is that, first of all, I think some of the VA hospitals are actually much better than they used to be. I know they are. My wife looks at them carefully in her job at the National Institute of Health. That's not to say they're by any means perfect or as good as they should be, but they've gotten better. My answer to that fundamentally is, if you've got a problem with the way veterans are treated in this country, talk to 317 million Americans. Nobody's got skin in the game. You know, you think that if our sons and daughters all had gone through what so many have gone through in Iraq and Afghanistan, that we would be indifferent to the way they were being treated by the VA and by the country generally? I don't think so. But because of the fact that most of us don't have skin in the game, it's kind of somebody else's problem. Well, they volunteered. It's a volunteer force, right? So, I think it's an outrage. And when I read stories about veterans panhandling on the streets of Grand Rapids or any other city in the country, it's heartbreaking. But I don't just blame the VA. I think that there's a broader issue here having to do with our attitude toward those who serve. Sir, hang on, she's coming.
Are there any comparative analysis of the importance between the Asian campaigns and the Europe-African campaigns? And if so, what are the conclusions from that?
Well, I'm not sure what you would mean by comparative analysis, but the truth is that...
Which is most important?
Well, if you fought in Europe, if you were at Iwo Jima, you know, we're fighting a two-ocean war. We're fighting on six continents, really. The battle plan, essentially, that had been agreed to shortly after Pearl Harbor by President Roosevelt and Prime Minister Churchill was that the preponderance of effort would be placed against the European Axis powers, especially Germany, and that Japan, even though Japan had just done us dirty at Pearl Harbor, would receive subsidiary treatment. And why was that? And by the way, it was one of the very few strategic decisions. It was the first big strategic decision made by Roosevelt and Churchill. And it was one of the very few in which there was unanimity among all the military brain trust for both the British and the Americans. And the reason for that, the reason for the decision and the reason for the unanimity of opinion is that it was recognized that Germany was by far the biggest and baddest of the enemies, that Germany's industrial base was far larger than Japan's, that Germany had the capacity really to be a very, very difficult foe, especially if we did not get into the fight and the Soviets, who had already made a non-aggression pact with them once, reneged on their obligations to their Western allies and somehow declared themselves neutral. Germany was going to be a lot tougher to beat without all that Russian blood being shed. And so the effort was placed primarily on Europe. Now, it has to be said that the United States Navy, having taken a good look at the Pacific and seen that as their primary theater, didn't pay much attention to that decision. And Ernest J. King, who was the chief of naval operations, sort of quietly shifted the overwhelming share of naval assets to the Pacific. All six Marine divisions were in the Pacific. You find very few Marines and no Marine units in Europe. So it's not like we were not fighting the Japanese, obviously. But I think in the long run, that was a wise decision to focus on the Germans. And I think that you have to say that it was borne out, that the theory behind it was essentially borne out. The Japanese were still fighting after the Germans surrendered, but they were supine. And it was a question of how many of us were going to have to die before they finally surrendered, atomic bomb, all the rest of it. So I don't think that it's very difficult to make the kind of analysis that you're talking about in any kind of rational way. Those who fought in the different theaters are very emotional about their theaters. But that's the historical reasoning behind the level of effort that went into the different theaters. Sir, right here. Hang on just a second. She's coming. He's right here in the maroon sweater.
Excuse me.
You mentioned that the Soviets killed many more Germans than the Allies did, maybe nine times as many. Could you comment about the significance of that for the Germans and the Allies in the European campaign in France?
Well, by the time we have invaded Normandy, June 6, 1944, the Russians are really prepared to steamroller into the Third Reich. They are quickly going to run through Poland. And by January 1945, the Russians are 40 miles from Berlin. January 1945. So, and they're killing Germans by the hundreds of thousands. And it's going to get worse. And they're going to rape 2 million German women, by the way, because they're very vengeful. Eisenhower has presumed from the get-go that Berlin is the objective. When they're having that meeting in the model room at St. Paul's, they talk about, ultimately, we're heading toward Berlin. And he presumes that through the fall and winter of 1944 until March of 1945, when he rather abruptly changes his mind and says, we're not going to Berlin anymore. This comes as a surprise to a lot of people, including Bernard Montgomery, and particularly Winston Churchill is very unhappy with this decision. And Eisenhower's logic is this. The political divisions of Germany in general and Berlin within Germany have all post-war divisions. That has all been decided already by the Allies. In October 1944, the partitions basically have been drawn on a map. We know that Germany is going to be divided and split into three zones of occupation, Soviets in the east, Brits and Americans in the west. We end up adding another one with the French. And we know that the same is going to happen to Berlin, that it will have zones of occupation. And this has been agreed to in October, and it is affirmed by the big three at the Yalta Conference in early February 1945. Yes, this is what we're going to do. So Eisenhower is looking at the map, and he's seeing several million Soviet soldiers on the doorstep of Berlin. He knows it's going to be a bloody fight because the Germans are showing no signs of giving up. He's told by Omar Bradley and others there could be 100,000 American casualties trying to take Berlin. And he knows that the political decisions, that regardless of who captures it, the other Allied powers are going to move in and have their piece of the city and the country. He does, I think, an incredibly smart, practical thing. He says, okay, well, we're not going to go to Berlin. We're going to let the Russians shed some more blood for Berlin. And they do. They have tens of thousands of casualties. If you've ever been to Berlin, there's an enormous mass grave in Treptow Park where those Russian soldiers are buried. Churchill doesn't like this decision because he believes that there is propaganda value and political value in beating the Russians there. But Roosevelt has made it very clear that, first, he doesn't want a conflict, and there have already been some close calls, aircraft, Soviet and American aircraft, mistaking each other for enemy aircraft. And particularly Roosevelt believes, Roosevelt has a month to live, by the way, at this point. Roosevelt believes that it's vitally important that whatever the shape of the post-World War world is, that we're going to have some kind of modus vivendi with the Russians. That his ambition is that the alliance that has seen us through the war will somehow be retained after the war and that there will be a cooperative feeling. And he doesn't want to endanger that by rushing willy-nilly to snatch Berlin away. So that's what happens. And Eisenhower steers the British and American armies under him farther to the south. They aim for Dresden. We end up in Czechoslovakia, actually. And he wants to, there's one other factor too. He wants to split the Reich in half. He wants to cut off Berlin and northern Germany from Bavaria because he is convinced, quite wrongly, really bad intel here, Ralph. I'm sure you had nothing to do with it. He's convinced that the Germans are planning a final redoubt, a national redoubt, they call it, in the Alps, and that tens of thousands of SS troops are pouring into the Alps and they're going to fight to the death and it's going to be impossible to wheedle them out without doing it one mountain crag at a time. This isn't true. The Germans don't have the capacity to do this. It doesn't even occur to Hitler until very late in the war to try something like this. So at any rate, all of these factors go into the decision making, and that affects what's happening in the late winter of 44-45 vis-a-vis the Russians. Sir, right there. Right there. Uh-huh.
Could you talk about some of Hitler's mistakes and rank them according to what was most important for the Allied victory?
How much time you got? Well, I'll do it briefly. I mean, his first mistake is to fight the Soviet Union. Now, he's got reasons for invading in June 1941. But the Third Reich is basically doomed at that point. Once the Americans get into it, he declares war right after Pearl Harbor against the United States. And so his generals generally realize this. They see, you know, we're fighting this enormous latent power. We've smashed them pretty good after the invasion of 1941, but they're reconstituting amazingly. The Soviets have moved a lot of their industrial base to the Urals, and they've got a new capital basically in Kubishev, and they're pulling themselves back together, and they're really, really mad. And they're going to die. As many of them have to die to destroy the Third Reich are going to die. And then at the same time, he's fighting the Western Allies. So that's a strategic error of the first order. Was it avoidable? Could he have eventually come to terms on a permanent level with the Soviet Union? I don't know. That's a counterfactual. Maybe, maybe not. You know, he thinks he's a great field marshal. Hitler does, and he's not. So that's a sort of general blanket. He is moving battalions around on the map. He is deciding where battalions should be fit. That's ridiculous. Real field marshals shouldn't be messing with battalions. That's a job for a brigade commander, a colonel, and not for the Fuhrer. So, and he really is convinced that he is channeling Frederick the Great. So that's another problem. And he's got some very, very fine generals, and he's got a great army. But he thinks that he is supposed to be directing it down to the particulars in a way that is really inimical to success for the German army. So those are a few. We could go on and on about that. So, yes, ma'am, right here. Hang on.
I probably can talk louder.
Yeah, but they can't hear. I can hear you, but they can't. Here she comes.
My question is about you as a writer. In listening to you and hearing about so much suffering, so much devastation, so much wasting of human life, particularly young people, were there times when you got depressed and had to get away from your subject?
Do I seem depressed? Do I feel depressed? I've been around war as a writer all my life, as a war correspondent and so on. I have no illusions about what it is. I know that war makes good soldiers do bad things. It makes bad soldiers do terrible things. And it does bad things to everybody involved. It is corrosive. I don't care how pure of heart you are or whether you've come back without a trace of PTSD, whatever war you've been in, it is corrosive. It's corrosive of individuals, it's corrosive of nations. So that depresses me. I'm not a pacifist, personally. I recognize that there are times when wars are inevitable and probably required. World War II would be at the top of that list for me. Having the comfort of examining decisions and actions 70 years after the fact, I can look back and say, why did you do that? I feel like I can reach back through history and take Eisenhower by the lapels and say, General, because he's not a very good field marshal. He makes a lot of mistakes. He's not Napoleon.
He doesn't see the field spatially and temporally the way a great battle captain does. That's not his job. His job, as he puts it, is to be chairman of the board, that's the phrase he uses, of the largest martial enterprise in the Western world. And he is great at that. But yeah, you look back and you see this general or that general or this lieutenant or that lieutenant do things that are foolish or harmful in some way. And that, yeah, that can be depressing. But I soldier on in my own comfortable way. The last thing I'll say about this before we get into psychotherapy. I'm of an age where when I came into the newspaper business, for example, in 1976, a little paper in Kansas, almost everybody who was older than I was had been in the military. My eventual friend and colleague, David Broder, he came here to every summer to Michigan, to the beaches. He'd been in the Air Force. My boss at the Washington Post, Ben Bradley, was in the Navy in World War II. My friend Bob Woodward was in the Navy for 5 years during Vietnam. Dan Balls, a great political writer, was in the Army. I'm just young enough that I was not. And I was not subject to the draft, and I was not. So writers my age, speaking specifically about journalists at the time, and younger, had no firsthand experience with the military. And it is having grown up in it, I knew the difference between a lieutenant and a lieutenant colonel and an F-16 and an M-16, which many didn't. And how could they? If you're not around them, how would you know? But the military has its own, those of you who've been there, and Ralph certainly knows, it has its own ethos, it has its own vocabulary, it has its own aura. It is a world. It is a big world, but it's quite removed from the civilian world that most of us know. So my feeling was that for those of us who are able to act as a kind of translator of that military world, and specifically in my case of war, for others who didn't know that was a kind of calling. And I still feel that. I feel that it is a calling, that it's something that I was meant to do. Not in a theological sense, but just as an accident of history. So.
One more question.
Okay, you pick him, Glebe.
Well, we had a question from a woman.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. We just had one.
All right.
I'm sorry, Ann. Now I'm really in trouble.
Start writing.
You better pick him now.
All right, there's a woman right there. Yes, ma'am. Hang on just a second.
What intrigued you most about the figure of Hitler, the personality, and the drive behind this monster?
To be honest with you, I don't find Hitler that intriguing. I don't think, the catastrophe is beguiling, certainly, and it's hard to avert your eyes when you begin looking at it, and obviously we've all been looking at it for 70 years. I don't find him personally to be that intriguing a character. I am more perplexed by the German people, 80 million Germans. I mean, this is the country of Mendelssohn and Beethoven and Mozart and Schiller and Goethe and all the rest of it. I was born in Germany. I lived in Berlin for several years. I have lots of German friends. I don't get it. I don't get it. And you know what? The Germans don't really get it either. The ability of Hitler to persuade 80 million Germans to do what they did. They did it. And every German school child knows they did it. Every German school child is trotted off to Dachau or Buchenwald or any one of a number of other camps and reminded they did it. They take it very, very seriously, and they are still 70 years after the fact trying to piece through it. I find other historical figures to be more intriguing, more human among other things. Hitler really is a kind of monster. And my attention and interest and affection is drawn toward those who are flawed. They all have feet of clay, and yet they are more worthy, I think, of our enduring interest. Part of my ambition is to find characters who have been lost to history, whom you perhaps have never heard of, but we ought not forget them. I could name a number of them. Jacob Devers, he was the commander of the U.S. 6th Army Group. You know Jacob Devers. Jake Devers. There are only three army groups in Eisenhower's force in Western Europe. Montgomery commands one of them. Omar Bradley commands the other. Who commands the third one? Jacob Devers. You know who Jacob Devers was? Well, not many Americans do, and he's a fantastic character. He's second only, he's from York, Pennsylvania. His father was a watchmaker. He's second only to Eisenhower in his ability to get along with allies, a natural penchant for it. Eisenhower is particularly good with the British. Devers has an even tougher problem. He has to get along with the French. His army group is one American army, the U.S. 7th Army, and the other army is the French 1st Army. And, oh my God, the French 1st Army commander, his name is Jean Delat de Tassigny. He's a fabulous, he's born to lead other men in the dark of night. He's really a great combat leader, but what a pain in the neck. He's described as an animal of action. Devers is very, very good at handling this guy. Delat would come into his office, you know, snap a salute, scream something in French at Devers, who spoke no French. French was his worst subject at West Point. But Devers did a very smart thing. He brought onto his staff a United States senator who had resigned his Senate seat and taken a commission in the Army as a lieutenant colonel named Henry Cabot Lodge. You've heard of him, you haven't heard of Devers, right? Henry Cabot Lodge had gone to school, I think, in Switzerland and was fluent in French. And so he acted as both translator and liaison to Delat. And Delat would scream something in French, salute again, walk back to the door, slam the door, come in, salute again, because he'd forgotten to salute enough times. And so that was Devers' cross to bear, dealing with Delat and other French. So I'm more intrigued by people like that, personally, than Hitler. So thank you so much. Thank you again.
Okay, I've got something for you. Okay, Joe?
Thank you.
Well, no speaker at the Hallenstein Center gets away, and Joe feels the same way about the Ford Foundation, without swag bags from our respective institutions. Rick, thank you so much.
Thank you, Gleaves.
There you go.
Well, thank you for coming.
Thanks, Joe.
And thank you for the great partnership.
Yeah, that was great.
Thank you.